Good morning. That cough sounded good.
I'm still coughing. How are you doing today?
I'm doing okay, I think. Yeah, I'm doing okay. I guess that's about it. Did your other student get added to my 143 Blackboard yet, or do you have a clue? Have they signed up?
All right, looks like we got connected again.
Yes, welcome back.
Yeah. Good deal. How's everybody in Keysville today?
Good.
I don't see anybody at your place. I don't know where Keith is. I know he had a doctor's appointment, said he may be leaving early. But...
Yeah, he said he's going to try to move it, but I haven't heard one way or the other, so...
I figured he'd be here for a little bit of it anyway, but it's not.
Yep.
Jasmine and Aaron, how are y'all this morning?
I'm the only one here. Aaron had something to do for work.
Okay.
Yes, wow. He told me to tell you that. I forgot.
Oh, it's all right. You're just a glutton for punishment, aren't you, Jasmine?
Yeah.
Yes, I am.
All right.
Oh, hurt.
Well... That's all right. You'll learn to like me. I tend to grow on people.
Or, yeah, like a good fungus.
Like a good fungus. Get in the hot seat again today. All right. Well.
Before you get going, what was the name of that other student you had that was going to be in my 143?
Greg Rasnick, he got signed up yesterday, and we're the IT guy added him to Blackboard, but he added him to the wrong site.
Okay, because he's not in my Blackboard yet.
No, he is working on it now, so it may not show up till tomorrow.
Okay.
But he was in their classes last semester. He should graduate this spring. I'm hoping he will. If he didn't screw up on his schedule and not get a couple classes, but he's transferring to Tech, so I don't know if he's too concerned about getting a degree here or not. You know what I mean?
Yep. Yes.
He's a worker. He has a lawn care business and a bunch of sheep and works at Lowe's. He's a good guy. But anyway. I don't know if I should talk about this or not before we get started. I've been debating it. Last night I had to say goodbye to a good friend of mine. He was he died Thursday, and they found him in his house dead, and they suspect he died a couple of days earlier, but the funeral was last night.
Sorry about that.
Yeah, and you know, the reason I bring this up, or this guy, when I first got out of college, my first job, I was working at Stewart Land and Cattle Company, and he was my manager. And so, you know, we talked quite a bit because he was the general manager of the farm, of all the three farms, and I was a manager of one of the farms, the Rich Mountain section. And so he was a guy I reported to directly. And I learned so much from him, you know, from cattle to managing people. It's like, you know, this guy knew cattle. He knew what a cow was going to do before the old cow did. But he also knew people. And he, you know, he was just a great manager. And of course, over the years, we developed a friendship, and or while I worked for him, we developed a good friendship. And then, you know, that friendship's continued on for the next 30 years or so. We'd probably talk about once a week. And, you know, so I talked to him the weekend before he died. But he was a very influential person in my life and really helped me a lot to learn and grow and progress in my career, and just a good person. But, you know, some of the examples that I use in class, real life examples, a lot of, you know, some of them are from him, or my experiences watching him handle people, or, you know, the things that we got into, or, you know, things I've learned from him over the years. You know, he was a great people manager as well as a good cattleman. And, in the farming industry, in agricultural industry, I kind of think that's a rare trait, you know. A lot of farmers aren't, you know, they may be better with their cattle or their crops than they are with people and communicating with people. But he had a unique ability, and he'll be missed. But you know, he was a good guy. But anyway, some of the examples and stories I tell, you know, from Stewart's, you know, he was a part of it. I learned a lot from him. But anyway, but he was just influential in my life and stuff. But anyway, get back. Now, Jasmine, I'm going to pick on you a little bit. Keith showed up. I'm going to leave Keith out of this. He turned in his job description already. to me, but, you know, he's on the ball, but he's also doing it for a grant that he's writing, and he has to have that done pretty quick, so he did that. But are you coming along okay with your job description?
Yes, I think so.
Okay. All right. I haven't heard from any of the online students of whether they're how they're coming along. Hopefully they are. If you have any questions, guys, give me a call or shoot me an email. The other day we finished up, we were talking about discrimination. You know, when you're writing this job description, you know, you can't discriminate. And we talked about the protected characteristics that you cannot discriminate against. And this will be a test question. You'll see it quite a bit on my exams. You cannot discriminate against age, sex, race, national origin, disability, or religion. Can y'all see that? I've got that up on the screen.
I can't see it. It's just a black screen.
Yeah, I don't know what's wrong with my screen. I don't know why it's not showing up.
Yeah, we haven't seen you at all.
I've cut them off, and I've cut them back on. And I was trying it again to see if they'll come up.
Well, we saw your desk for a minute.
Yeah, for some reason it's not hooking it over to the computer, is it?
Yeah, but now we see you.
Right. Let me see if it throws it on that document camera. It's not even showing it on the document camera right now. I have to tell Joe to see what's going on there. All right. Yeah, well, the document camera's showing up, isn't it? The Elmo,
yep.
But it's not showing up on the computer. There you go. All right. Can y'all see that now?
Yes.
Okay. So, in your job descriptions, your interview questions, and everything you do on these projects, you're not going to be able to discriminate. You know, you can't write it for a certain sex or a certain race or religion. And we talked a little bit about disabilities the other day. And you can't discriminate according to a person's religious beliefs. You know, and that disability, guys, you know, that's a good reason we could set up a practical exam. Just because a person may have a disability, it doesn't mean they may not be able to do the chores or the tasks that come with that job. So, you know, if they can do it, then you're going to have to hire them. So that physical, a practical type exam would help protect you in that instance, you know. People will lie to you. They'll tell you they know how to do something and have no clue on how to do it, or that they tell you they can do it and they don't. They can't do it. I've experienced that before, and I'm sure Keith has and Tom. But you know, people will lie to get a job. So, you know, you just can't go with what they say. You know, like on a resume, job application, and interview. They'll tell you what you want to hear. So, you know, having that good practical exam and maybe a written exam will really give you an idea of what your candidates actually know and what they can actually do. So the more of these selection tools that we use in the hiring process, the better chance we're going to get to find the right fit for. We also talked about two two types of discrimination. Disparate treatment, which is just outright discrimination, and adverse impact. An adverse impact, we said, is having qualifications higher than what the job actually requires. And we just use like a high school diploma for a tractor driver. You know, you don't have to have a high school diploma to be able to drive a tractor, run implements. But, you know, you may need to know, make sure they know how to use a GPS system if your tractors have those on there. Some other laws which we have to abide by is the federal equal opportunity, employment opportunity law, Civil Rights Act, Equal Pay Act, Age Discrimination Act, and the Americans with the Disabilities Act. And there's several, there's a Rehabilitation Act, Genetic Information and Non-Discrimination Act, another Civil Rights Act. Guys, like I told you, first day of class, there's all sorts of laws out there. You know, when you, if you get into HR, when you're going through this stuff, you know, don't be afraid to consult an attorney to make sure you're being legal. Laws change constantly, and, you know, maybe by the time you get out into, you know, doing HR work in real life, you may have a whole different set of laws, or these may be, you know, not apply anymore. I don't know what the future brings. So, you know, don't be afraid to consult a lawyer. It's in the long run, it's going to be cheaper than you getting in trouble. The other thing that you need to know is document everything. It's for your protection that you're doing it right. Okay? You'll see that on an exam. I can't remember my question on that, but it is important to document everything. If you don't document, it doesn't happen. Okay?
So, question for you.
Yes, sir.
In regards to documentation, are you subject to review? Can the government come in there and say, I understand you had a job opening, how many females, males, minorities applied and all that kind of stuff? Or do you just pretty much pick the best candidate and don't worry about that kind of information?
You know, I think if you have good documentation and, you know, your steps of what you did, everything's documented, I wouldn't worry about it. Now, that does happen. You know, my dad, when he was working before he retired, and you know, this was back in the 70s, maybe the 80s. They came in, and the government came in and said, you know, you're being racist because you don't have any black people working for you. And they said, well, let's drive around town because we don't have any black people in town. And they said, well, you know, you're being sexist because the only women you have up here are the ones, you know, the only jobs they're doing are secretarial jobs. They're not in the manufacturing or whatever. And so, you know, they pulled out their documentation and showed them, you know, here's the applicants that we get. Here's our hiring process. And so, you know, they were okay with that. Granted, they wanted them to go out of the area to hire people of different races and bring them into this small coal mining community to work for them. But, you know, people aren't going to do that very often. But it all, you know, luckily they had the documentation and it wasn't pursued any further.
Okay, thanks.
So the documentation and their deal came back to help them out quite a bit. So anyway, you know, you need to be aware there's several laws out there, and it's not going to hurt to work or get a lawyer's advice to make sure everything is on the up and up. And always document to protect yourself. Now, you know, not only can we not discriminate in the hiring process, these same laws also hold true for any aspect in, of employment. Whether you're hiring or you're firing, you're transferring to another position, promotions, layoffs, or recalling people from a layoff. So, you know, these hold true all the way through their employment with you. You just cannot discriminate at all. When you write your job announcement and advertising, you got to make sure it's not discriminatory. You know, for your advertisements, recruitments, even your testing. You know, if you have a written test or a practical test and or if somebody's disabled, you're going to have to make arrangements for them to be able to take that exam. And those arrangements have to be within reason. You know, something you don't have to spend a whole lot of money on to make that accessible to them.
Another question for you in regards to testing. You hear a lot of stuff about inherent bias in testing and stuff. So are you talking about actual job performance tests? Are you talking a written test? And how would you protect yourself? Would you submit that written test to an outside consultant, make sure you don't have any inherent biases in it or something? How is that done?
You know, you could if you wanted to, but, you know, I would think, you know, from what I've read, because I've never been submitted to I've never had to take a written test. Okay.
Okay.
So personally, I don't know from personal experience, but from what I've read in the textbook and research for the class, most of the written exams are pertaining to the subject matter in what the job you're going to be doing. So, say for instance, you're looking, you know, in your case, for bees, you know, you may give them, and it was more than an entry level position. Okay, say you've got a whole bunch of hives and you're hiring a bee manager. Okay, you know, you may give them a written test regarding the different parasites that bees get, and treatment, things like that, things that pertain to what they're doing. Does that make sense?
Well, what I was formulating in my mind was kind of, you know, making like a little introductory type package of bee information, and then you pre-select the people that I think would be the best and have them read that material and then give them a little short either oral or possibly a written exam on that material, just kind of one, see if they can read and understand and logically put together the steps involved to do the job.
Okay. I don't know. Tom, you pipe up on this. I'll tell you my opinion. I don't think there would be anything wrong with that. You know, as long as you let them know you're going to, you know, if they pursue this position for you, you know, you're going to have a test on, you know, to see, make sure that you can read and comprehend and put things together.
Right. That would be the purpose.
You used a phrase that a little bit scared me though. You were going to be looking beforehand to come up with the, you know, looking at them to figure out which ones you were going to give them the test.
No, say I have 10 applicants and I'm down to the 5. I'm really considering. Then at that time, I'd probably offer this test or evaluation to those 5 finalists, not to the general 10.
Yeah, I mean that's the way to do it. But I guess sort of make sure that you've covered yourself on the selection process. That the other 5 you've already eliminated for some legitimate reason.
Right.
Whether it's and that's kind of thing, because your test, you're already going to be trying to get some basic knowledge. Can they read? Can they write? That kind of thing. So, and you know, if experience may or may not be that important, then there's a question of, you know, what are the reasons why you're eliminating these people from taking the test?
Well,
because usually, a lot of times, the tests, because they take time and they're expensive, is you usually save those till later in process. And at that point, you've already weeded out people for various reasons. Right. But if you're, you know, this is sort of an entry level beginning of the process.
It's not a pre-screening, but okay, it was a final screening, I guess.
Okay. Yeah, it's a final after you've already, you've checked their references, you've checked their background, and they've got the education and whatever, then you're like, okay, I think you're the person, but I want you, I think y'all are the people, but I want y'all to take the test, then you're fine with that.
I guess the main reason why I'm thinking about this is because the chemicals I use, they're harmless, but they can be harmful if they're misused. And I want to make sure somebody knows how to make solutions and those kind of things.
You know, one thing you may want to think about having your candidates do, or one of their requirements in that situation, is to have their private pesticide license.
Yeah, because, and that way you let, the extension service or whoever do the ugly work of washing them out or whatever in the first place.
That's a good idea. So they would just contact the extension agent for that.
Yes, because they've changed the laws on that private pesticide license.
Okay.
You know, when it comes to pesticides, the label is the law.
Right.
And so if they cannot read, they cannot get their license.
Okay. So I need to put that in my job description that I submitted to you already then, right? Must have a viable pesticide license or current pesticide license. Is that what I need to put in there?
Yeah, that or must be able to obtain it within so many days of employment.
Okay, there you
go. I was going to say that next.
Obtain.
Yes.
And that's good. Okay.
Because you're going to be dealing with pesticides with those bees, and even for liability reasons for your company, that would be a good practice to have, because you know I would imagine there's withdrawal periods. You know, if you treat bees for Verona, for the Verona mites, I'm sure there's a time period that you cannot harvest that honey. Or that first batch of honey right after that treatment has to, you know, you have to throw it out. So that
Stuff you're doing it now, because in time that you'll harvest later this spring, the chemical residue is gone and stuff. No, it's like formic acid. We use that, and so, but if that's misused, that could kill the bees and also be harmful to the employee, and then a lot of this stuff comes in, and documentation, government regulations, is disposal, making sure that I'm subject to spot check on my record keeping, make sure that I just didn't dump it out in the field or dump it down the drain type stuff.
You're exactly right. And, you know, something for you on that, you know, for your liability protection, you know, where you're selling that, you know, you need to have yours as well. In fact, you may have to have it in order to buy some of those.
Yeah, that I do. I already have mine, but that was. But one other question regards to testing. Say you, in your position, you're hiring a candidate for your animal husbandry class. Now, would you go into details like you did in the last quarter with cattle, like for us to breed, the gestations and stuff? Would that be too much information to be testing somebody, or would you just be testing them on their general knowledge of working around animals?
I guess it would depend on what position I'm hiring for. Okay, if I'm looking at hiring a farmhand, you know, to help me with cattle and stuff, you know, I would probably, one thing I would want to do is set up a practical exam and have them run a few, you know, where they have to sort some cattle out and run them down the chute. I've gotten really picky about cattle handling. you know, I've seen so many people work, been around people working cattle a lot. And, you know, I'll go to places, man, they've got sticks and they're banging and hooping and hollering and pushing hard and, you know, just putting way too many cattle in the back of the chute trying to move them up, and they get him, you know, there's just not any room for them to move. And I've also seen people that can just move cattle and not do, you know, you don't hear any words said other than maybe just a little, come on, get up there. And the guy I told you just died, he was one of those guys. You know, man, I loved working cattle with him because it was all body position and you know, of getting cattle to do what us what we wanted to do without hooping and a hollering and overuse of cattle sticks. You know, we kept our cattle calm, cool, you know.
Right.
It was a lot safer environment. So I would probably, you know, if I was just looking for a general farmhand, I would probably do more of a practical type exam.
Okay.
To see, you know, because a lot of times when people get abusive with animals, they're scared. So, you know, I would definitely have them sort and run some cattle up a chute just to see how comfortable they are with cattle. I'd probably have them hook up a couple of implements on the tractor and demonstrate their knowledge with that. And then, you know, whatever else I'm involved in or into, you know, I would incorporate a task or something to see what they knew or didn't know about it. Does that make sense?
Yeah, very much so. Thank you.
You know, if it was more of a management type position, I might do a practical exam or a written exam regarding their knowledge. But I wouldn't have something on there like, I'd probably do something, more questions related to nutrition and that nutrition reproduction interaction than, you know, what's the gestation length of a cow? Because to me, that should be common knowledge in the cattle industry.
Thanks.
Does that make sense?
Sure does. Thank you.
All right. So anyway, with any of whatever we're doing, we can't discriminate. You know, even if it's just some, you know, training, apprenticeship programs, using the company facilities. You know, one of the perks of working in agriculture, working on a farm, is, you know, your boss usually lets you use the farm shop. And so, you know, if you do it with one, you need to let everybody else do that. You know, if their car breaks down and they can use pull it into the shop and use your tools to fix it, you know. You know, you just can't discriminate at all. Fringe benefits, pay, retirement, leave, and any other types of conditions of employment. You just can't. Discrimination's wrong, okay? Some other discriminatory practices are harassment, you know, riding somebody pretty hard to try to get them to leave. If somebody files a discrimination charge or a whistleblowing or anything like that, report you to the labor board. Whatever case, you know, one of your employees does, you cannot retaliate against them. You can't fire them. And you can't harass them for doing that. They are legally protected with the whistleblowing and filing a discrimination charge and stuff like that. You can't discriminate based on stereotypes or assumptions. You can't assume that, you know, make assumptions about people. You know, well, I'm not going to hire a Muslim because I have gas tanks here and he'll blow the place up. you know. You just can't make that assumption. You can't deny employment opportunities or treat any your employees differently because of marriage to or associated or they're associated with a person of a different race, religion, nationality, etc. Any questions on those, guys?
This is not a smart ass question, but I've just was sitting here thinking when you said that, if you were a pig farmer and you had a Muslim come and apply for the job, how would you handle that?
Yeah, it is.
I didn't know. I just didn't know somebody, you know, had a lawyer. They just want to see your action, possibly take you to court, or how would you handle that?
You know, it could be a setup like that.
Right.
You know, if I would think if they're a sincere, true, practicing Muslim, and with their aversion to swine, they're not going to apply to that. They're not going to apply for that position because you know they're not allowed to eat pork. But from my understanding, they're not allowed to do anything with swine.
Okay, so, I didn't know that.
Well, and by that...
What's that, Tom?
I was going to say, by that, they wouldn't be qualified to take the job because they can't do the job if they can't touch the pigs. They can't do what they're supposed to do.
I knew they couldn't eat pork.
Right.
I didn't know about the other part.
But wouldn't that be discrimination against their religion?
Well, not if the job and in the job description says, you know, part of the job is, you know, picking up pigs, vaccinating pigs.
Right.
You know,
and that's
deworming
what I said.
Yes. You got to lay
you know,
have those job requirements in there.
Right. Have them in there. But a true practicing Muslim's not shouldn't be applying for that job.
Yes.
So if they did, it's probably a setup. And I'd go talk to a lawyer to protect myself from that point on because they're trying to...
Or you send them out there to do their job test before they get hired. And if they don't pick up the pig and do things, there you go.
Just have some pork sandwiches for lunch.
That you
might be asking for. Give them a BLT, right?
Yeah.
All right. Any questions on that stuff, guys? Okay. Let's move on and start talking about people management. And let's talk about management first. Or talk about management a little bit. There's a manager, it's a tough position, okay? Because you're in a position of pushing the employees to get production, and if you're not and at the same time, you're having to answer to your management, okay? So you're kind of a middleman, and you're going to get dumped on both sides, from the employees to management. You know, they're all going to get at you, unload on you at some point in time. But to be successful, you're going to have good people skills. And, you know, you can read all you want, I keep saying guys. Jasmine, I'm not trying to discriminate against you. It's just a habit of mine.
Fine.
But it takes practice and experience to build these skills. You will mess up. Man, I've sure messed up, you know, and I've learned from my mistakes and gone on. But, you know, to build skills that we need as managers. And there's some skills that the book talks about, three essential management skills that that you need to have as a manager or an employee or an employer, okay? You need to be concerned about productivity, and that's a no-brainer because you're in this business to make money, right? You're going to have production, something to sell. So you got to have that concern for productivity, but you also have to have that concern about your employees. Okay, so that first skill is you have to be concerned for production and your employees. Because you're not going to have that production without your employees. So it's a balancing act. You also have to understand human resource management. You have to know the laws. You need a document. You need to follow the laws and make sure everything is kosher or everything's on the up and up, legal, on the legality end of it. Because you can be shut down and lawsuits and fines levied against you to put you out of business. And then the other thing you need to do or be able to do is to have a purposeful action. You know, I've been on, you know, been the low man on the totem pole, and I've been in a management position and everywhere in between. And, you know, the managers that, you know, we stayed busy. Don't get me wrong. You got, you know, they're paying me for my time. I'm going to work now, whether it's pushing the broom or doing whatever I need to do. You know, there's not a job I'm beneath or anything like that. But sometimes you can't help but wonder, what's the purpose of this? You know, why am I doing this task? And, you know, is it just busy work until I go home? Or is this something, does this task contribute to the greater good or the bigger picture? You know, and I think we've all had that question before, whether it was even, you know, homework at school. You know, why do we have to do this homework? Or why do we have to do this? Is this just busy work, you know, to keep us quiet? Or, you know, busy work just to make our lives difficult? So, so even if it's a very menial task, you know, make sure that your employees understand that it's for the bigger picture. Does that make sense? So, you know, these notes are on Blackboard, guys. But, you know, it's people management skills. And it's tough. It's tough to really balance this first one, productivity and employees. How do you get done? How are you going to get push your employees for that productivity and at the same time not abuse them, not put them in dangerous situations, and show concern for them? Or, you know, if you approach it as the buddy-buddy system with the employees, how are you going to motivate them to get that production? It's a fine line there. It's tough. People struggle with it all the time. No, I don't care how many years you've been here.
Well, and the question for you, as far as managing and motivating people, is it best to pay someone for the job or pay them for their hourly work?
That depends, and we'll talk about that later in the semester on how you come up with pay, whether you pay them for that job, or you pay them by the hour. You know, it's common in agriculture, let's take blueberries, for instance, to bring in workers, and they're paid by production, by how many buckets or bins of, blueberries they pick, or pumpkins. They get paid by how much they do instead of by the hour. There's positive and negative aspects to however way you go.
Okay.
So, you know, if you're doing it by production, it needs to be, you need to make that clear. And it has to be within their control. You know, if you're paying a technician and paying them on production only, you know, they can't control the weather, which influences the flowering of the plants for the bees to collect the honey.
Right.
Does that make sense?
Yes, very much. Thanks.
Okay. Now, as managers, what do we expect from our workers? And if you're a worker, you know, if you haven't been in a management position, you know, hopefully as you look at it through this, it'll help you become a better employee when you see things from the other side of the fence, or look at it at a different perspective. But what do you think managers expect from their workers? Or what do you expect the managers, what do you think managers expect from their workers?
Show up to work on time and be ready to go to work and do the job. And if they have any questions, ask so they can do their job.
Okay. Jasmine, what do you think?
I think they want them to do the job like they were hired to do the job.
All right. Those are good answers, and they're both correct. Okay, we as managers, we expect a lot from our employees. We expect them to show up to work on time and do their job, and we really expect them to do a high quality work, don't we? We don't want them to do a sloppy job. We want them to do good quality work and do it in a timely basis. You know, if it's a task that should take an hour, we don't want them just beating in their time and making it last all day long. Correct? How about, do we expect our employees to take their responsibility seriously?
Yes.
Most definitely.
Yeah. We want them to be serious about their job, to take the responsibility seriously. And that doesn't mean that they can't cut up, joke around, you know, and have a good time while doing it. But they need to take that responsibility of their job seriously. So much so that they even go beyond the call of duty. You know, that's ideal, right? You know, they see something else that needs to be done, or hey, something's getting ready to break. Let's just go ahead and fix this before it causes a breakdown for us. Or they're driving home, you know, they're driving home from work, and they see a cow mired down in a bog, and they pick up the phone and say, "Hey, we got a cow stuck in the mud over here. Let's, you know, we got to get her out." You know. And is willing to put in that extra time, going above and beyond their responsibilities. That's what we want, right? We may not always get it, but that's what we expect from our employees. We also expect them to be concerned about our operation and about other employees, right? Because if the farm or our business is not successful, they're not going to have a job. But we want them to be concerned about the job, about our farm or our business, and want it to succeed. And we also want them to care about their other employees, get along with them, and develop a relationship with them and stuff like that. We don't want contention, right? You ever had to work around a bunch of people that couldn't stand each other?
Yes.
Yeah, I heard that laugh. I know you've experienced it. What about you, Jasmine?
Not really.
Count yourself lucky.
I haven't had that many jobs, so.
Okay. Well, that's all right. But I can tell you, when you're having to work with a bunch of people and they don't like each other, it makes for a long day.
And it's a dangerous day, too, because a lot of times they're setting up their coworker or something so that they get in trouble, and it makes the other person look good, too.
Yeah. I mean, people can be wicked. It's not a good conducive environment when they don't get along. You know, and the other thing that we
Let me just back up a second. I was just thinking there, getting back to my other question. So in your hiring process, if you had a qualified Muslim and a qualified Jewish person, would you be accused of discrimination if you didn't hire one of them because you wanted to avoid any potential future conflict?
Where do you come up with these questions?
My brain's in high drive this morning.
He's one of those problem employees that nobody gets along with.
That's right. Hypothetically, I'm just sitting there. No, I've just been doing a lot of reading about stuff, and you know, you ask one question and you get 10 more questions, and all of a sudden it's like consult a lawyer, and I says, man, this is dangerous stuff here.
Well, you know, in today's time, you know, that is a valid question.
First thing comes to my mind would be, if you already have one of them working for you, say the Muslim is already working for you, if it comes up in the interview that the other person is, if they admit that they're Jewish, because you can't ask them if they're Jewish, but if they tell you they're Jewish, then you legitimately can ask the question of, given the tensions there, do you think you could work with a Muslim person? And because part of the job is working with other people, and that might take care of half of it right there, because that person's already admitted to their religion and they've said they can't do the job because they can't work with the other person. Now, if maybe that person can work with them, but then your Muslim employee you already have can't, but there's nothing you can do about that until you fired the second person. At least that's my thinking.
So, yeah, I agree with Tom on that one. That's a dangerous slope on not hiring somebody. You're going to get into discrimination just not hiring them on religion.
So put in your job description, if you have a multi-ethnic workforce, and you think it's an issue, put in your job description the ability to work with a multi-ethnic workforce.
Okay.
Stick it in if that's what you've got to do.
Yeah, that would be a good way to handle that.
Because unfortunately, otherwise you cannot ask about their religion. The person might look Jewish, but you can't assume that they are. Okay. And so you can't ask that question to know that there's a problem unless they admit to it. So you just put the blanket, you've got to be able to work with people.
So you have two good workers, one Muslim, one Jewish, and you've hired them, and then you find this out that they can't get along and it's detrimental to your business. What do you do then?
Well, And we'll get, you know, in the later chapters throughout the semester, you know, we're going to talk about if, you know, discipline and firing and protecting yourself during those processes. and we're going to talk about employee discipline. So maybe that will be answered later in the semester.
Okay, well, a lot of my questions are coming from what I'm doing on my own, just reading different manuals and stuff, and it's a very complicated subject.
But part of it
is complicated.
Yes, part of it would be, can you have them working separate from one another? One of them's on one side of the farm, the other's on the other. One of them's working first shift, the other's working second shift. If you have a personality conflict, you can start maneuvering that kind of stuff. But it gets ugly if you, you know, you've only got five hives and they both have to work at the same time. You know, so they're going to be right there. Then that's when it gets ugly.
Okay, well, thank you. I won't ask any more questions.
That's all right. It makes me think. I'm just picking on you where you come up with these questions, but they are good questions. And
oh, I stay awake at night when I get these pearls of wisdom. I write them down.
Yeah,
I'm gonna call his wife and take away his ink pens.
Okay. Think of ways to torture Dwayne or stump Dwayne. But those are good questions, Keith. And the other thing that we'd want our employees to do is to represent our community, our business well in the community. You know, you don't want to go to town, you know, to pick up supplies and, you know, you're talking to, you know, the guy there at the co-op or wherever you're shopping, and they say, man, I hear bad things about what's going on your farm. Or you don't want, you know, your wife to go to the garden club or whatever little, you know, whatever civic activity she's in and hear somebody, you know, somebody say, boy, y'all, your husband, he's a bear to work for. Or, you know, or hear bad stuff through the rumor mill about your operation. You know, you want your employees to represent your company well in the community. So, you know, these are, again, guys, this is on Blackboard. But these are what we expect from our workers. And I don't think, you know, I don't think that's too much to ask of them. I think that's just kind of, to me, some of these are common sense, you know. At least from my experience managing people, you know, I like for people to be on time. I like for them to do their job and take their job serious. You know, it doesn't mean we can't joke and carry on while we're doing it, but I want them to do their job, and I want them to go above and beyond if necessary. You know, in the farm, in agriculture, man, it's nothing uncommon for that. You know, you'll be getting ready to go out to dinner with my wife, or we're getting ready to go to church, and the cows broke through the fence. Everything's come to a standstill to get the cows in and take care of the situation. Or cows calving, or a horse got cut up, whatever it is. You know, those things happen all the time. Or, you know, it's a common deal in agriculture. And Jasmine, if you're looking at going into veterinary medicine, you know, you're going to be getting calls all the time. Midnight,
yeah.
2 o'clock in the morning. You know, as you and your husbands get, or you and, you know, your husband's getting ready to go out to dinner, here comes the pager coming in. Hey, I got a colicky horse. Well, honey, I got to go to work. Sorry. We would do that for our business. We expect our employees to do that as well. They help us. And I sure like the people that I had working with me or under me. I like to say with me instead of under me. But, you know, you've got to work with people. Don't have the attitude that you're, you know, they're working under you. You're going to have some management issues. But you're going to, you know, I want them to be worried about the operation. I want them to speak good about the company in public. So, you know, I mean, that's just common courtesy things that we ask, and I don't think it's above and beyond or anything out of the way. It's just what's expected. Now, on the flip side of the coin, let's talk about the employees for a minute. And we've all been there. We've all been an employee. What do we expect from our managers?
Speaking of personal experience, I think expect the managers to give you the tools to do your job and be successful and then leave you alone so you can do your job.
Okay. Provide what you need to get the job done and let you do it. Don't micromanage.
Exactly.
Jasmine, what do you think?
I guess about the same. Don't look over my shoulder every 5 minutes.
Okay.
One of the biggest ones for me is give me the tools that I need in order to do the job you want me to do.
Yeah.
I've experienced that up and down all throughout my career, you know, teaching, working in the real world, doing construction work. You ask me to do something and then my hands are tied. Nothing irritates me more than that.
Yeah. I like having the proper, you know, having what I need to get the job done.
I'll give you a prime example. When I was in high school, I was hired to paint the cabana clubs down at the Old Cavalier, Virginia Beach, and being paid by the hour. And the paint, I guess that winter froze, and it was like paste. And you ever tried painting a building with paste? And the manager said, well, that's what they sent us. That's what you have to use. And we did the best we could, and, of course, we got hell for the job because it looked terrible. And so it was a reflection on us and not a reflection on the manager.
Yeah, that would be very frustrating because, you know, you didn't have the proper stuff to do the job. And, you know, and that's a pet peeve. You know, it was – and that's happened to me, you know, when I first started at Stewart's. Yeah, I just assumed we had tools. You had to have your own tools because past history showed with that farm, those tools would grow legs and walk off. So, you know, I had to have my own fence, you know, other than like wire stretchers, you know, I had to have my own hammers, my own fencing pliers. I had to have my own wrenches and sockets for mechanic work. They didn't provide any tools. And, you know, that's tough to deal with, you know, because the other farms I'd worked on, man, they were just there in the shop. Whatever you needed, they had. So it's frustrating when you just don't even have the basic tools to do what you got to do.
Even things like, not to talk smack about our colleges, but, you know, they'll spend $50,000 or whatever on somebody's salary, but then they won't cough up, you know, $300, $500 or something like that in order to give that $50,000 person the tools they need in order to teach. It's just like, you know, not to talk smack about Southwest, but, you know, y'all's audio equipment, you know, it would only take a few $100 to replace the whole thing and have a lot less stress on you, a lot less stress on the students, and we'd have a connection here. You know, we've got the same thing going on here, and just, you know, I'm not going to speak for a lot of employees, but, you know, we don't want to say, yeah, cut my pay by $1,000 and take that $1,000 and buy me better equipment in the classroom. But if they would do the better classroom equipment before giving out the raises kind of thing to where people's jobs are easier and better, they may not notice that they didn't get the raise kind of thing, but they will notice that their job has improved, the quality of that 8 hours a day that they're on a job has improved, and you'll end up with a lot happier, more productive workers.
I agree. But as it was explained to me, Tom, we look at things from a practical sense, a practical business sense, and the government doesn't operate that way.
Yes, all you had to do was use the word government.
You know, they were, to give you a prime example or that how that came about to me, I was sitting, we were at a in-service meeting, and the president of the college was talking about a fundraising activity to build something, right? And 10 minutes later, he was talking about the budget and how short we are with the budget and talking about cuts. And I said, you know, I don't understand why they want to build new buildings when they can't even meet their budget to do this, this, and this. And this business lady, she looked at me and she said, Dwayne, and she's a farmer, okay, or her husband farms. She says, Dwayne, you look at it from a too practical sense of view. Government doesn't operate like this. It's a whole different ballgame. There's pots for everything. The pot for the building does not operate the pot for the budget. It's a whole different ballgame.
We're laying off people here, and they're going to be starting to build a new building here on our campus within the next year. But just another example, when I was teaching in a middle school in North Carolina, I was supposed to be teaching agriculture, but they changed it to exploring biotechnology to middle school kids. And I was supposed to be teaching gene splicing, cloning, DNA, all this kind of junk. And all they gave me was a notebook with coloring sheets. And I'm teaching in the wood shop. And so all the money that they were spending on my salary, and I had nothing to work with other than a notebook full of coloring sheets and crossword puzzles to give the kids. That was a nightmare. I mean, utter nightmare. Yeah. I mean, my blood pressure was up. I was still mad when I got home from work every afternoon. I mean, it was just... It was terrible. It was absolutely terrible. I quit. I got out of there just for my health. I really did.
Yeah. So, you know, and I'm sure we can go on with horror stories like that. It's important, you know, as employees, you know, we want a work environment where we can do our job, have the tools necessary, and also to develop our skills over time. Because if we develop more skills or get better at what we do, you know, we expect more money with that increased skill knowledge, right? So, you know, we want an environment where we can do our job, do it well, and continue to develop our skills and knowledge so that we had the potential to earn more money. Another thing that we like as employees, and this wasn't mentioned, but we want to feel valued. You know, we want management to value our opinions or our feelings about something. You know, we just don't want to be dismissed. What do they know? They just work for us. He's just a part-time instructor. He doesn't know what his opinion doesn't matter. You know, we don't like that. We want to be valued. Another thing we like, and we mentioned this the other day in class, is positive feedback. You know, when we do something good, you know, we like you know, good job. We want a sincere thank you. Another thing that we expect as employees, and this is important, and this has happened to me on two occasions. We get offered a job and we accept it. And we do our job or just take the position, we expect that our manager and our employer will meet those terms and conditions of our employment. You know, last semester, and you're well aware of this, I took a job as a feed salesman. And, you know, I interviewed for the job. They called. They offered me a job. And they told me what it would pay. And, you know, I was okay with that. I get down to go be trained. And they're sitting there changing the whole pay structure, knocking me out of thousands of dollars. They did not meet and agree upon the conditions of employment. I was done. I quit. I was pretty ticked, big time, you know. So as employees, we want our employers to do what they say, to meet those agreed terms of employment. That also happened to me one other time. You'd have thought I learned my lesson the first time, guys. You know, this was several years ago. I took a full-time job at a stable training horses. The owner told me, I'll pay you $13 an hour, 10% commission on any horses you sell, and I'll provide your health insurance. What did dummy me do? Boy, I jumped at that I jumped on that job. I mean, I had an indoor arena to ride in year-round in the wintertime. I had outdoor arena for the summertime. I had horses bred by some of the top stallions in the reining horse industry standing in there for me to break and ride. I had died and gone to heaven. We even had people that cleaned out the stalls and fed. All I had to do was go in and ride horses. Life was sweet. I'm not lying to you. It could not have got any better than that. My ideal job. Good horses. Good place to ride. Didn't have to worry about mucking stalls. Didn't have to worry about feeding. All I had to do was just go ride horses all day. I got my first paycheck. Minimum wage. Sold my first horse. Didn't get commission. I quit. I said, I ain't working for a liar anymore. I'm done with you. You'd have thought I'd learned my lesson so that when I took another job, I would have got everything in writing. I guess the years kind of blinded me, or I don't know. But anyway, it's happened twice in my life. You get offered a job, you get everything in writing, guys. Protect yourself as an employee. Document. Not only is it a manager looking at it from a managerial perspective, you know, going through this hiring process and documenting everything to protect you, but as an employee, document to protect you. Make sure they're going to hold true to their word. And the other thing we want as employees, we just want to be treated with courtesy, you know, be consistent the way you treat, you know. Boy, I worked for this one guy, you know, and he was a good guy. He meant well, but he was different type personality. Man, he'd go off at you in 1 minute, yell and scream, and the next minute he'd bend over backwards to do, you know, to help you out any way he could. Very inconsistent. You know, I mean, but in all, he was a good guy. He was a really good employer. But, you know, he had that temper, and you didn't know what set him off, but as soon as it blew over, it was okay. But typically, we like to be treated with, you know, in a consistent manner and courteous environment at work. Keith, Jasmine, do y'all agree with those? Or?
Yeah, the one thing that I was always gripe me is when the workday ends and the social hour begins, because a lot of times in a different workforce, the ones, I hate to say it, the one that kisses ass is the ones that gets recognized and promoted, whether they go out drinking with the manager after hours or they're the hunting buddies or whatever else. And that was always a point of dissension with me, because I don't drink and So I kind of felt, you know, kind of left out of the out of that scheme.
Yeah, I understand where you're coming from, you know, and on ranches I worked at, you know, it wasn't unusual for the, you know, all the cow, you know, heck, you get west of the Mississippi, beer's made from water, so there's no need to drink water. Water's for bathing, beer's for drinking, and they get their water from beer. I mean, at lunch, they pull out a cooler of beer and start drinking beer with their lunch, and then go on work the rest of the day. And people don't get stupid like they do here. Now, I didn't drink, okay? You know, I'd go hang out with them after work. I was a designated driver sometimes. And, you know, sometimes their boss, their manager would come along with us, you know. So, you know, even though I didn't drink, you know, I still went out with them. But it happens, you know, and that's something as managers that we don't want, you know, that's a fine line, again, going back to showing concern about your employees. You don't want to cross that line and play favoritisms. And that happens a lot in real life. Ideally, you don't want to show favoritism. And, you know, promotions, the raises come around, you want it to be based on merit and not on who you go out, you know, who's your roping buddy for jackpot roping Saturday. You know what I mean? So that, you know, that's a valid concern there. But it does happen. And as managers, that's something that we want to avoid.
Thank you.
Yeah, but that's a good point. So we'll end here. Looks like we got the next class coming in, and we're about out of time. So getting on a different topic.
One more question for you.
Yes, sir.
As far as our tests that we're responsible for, should we rely solely on your PowerPoint presentations and lecture notes, or should we be concentrating a lot on the chapters on the computer program?
You know, the PowerPoints, you know, and the lecture notes, I'm going to draw a lot from. You know, of course, you know, I read the book, read the chapters, and prepare my lectures. And by you reading the book, you know, hopefully it will help you understand this stuff better and get a better concept. I'm not going to go through there and ask some obscure question from the book. It would be
okay.
Something we did discuss. Does that help you?
Yeah, because the book is pretty detailed, goes a lot more depth. That's what I was worried about.
It does. You know, and if I go into that much depth, we're not going to get out of chapter one.
That's right.
You know, I expect you guys to read the book and understand the concepts, you know, that I'm going over. All right, guys, any other questions?
Let's do it. Thank you, sir.
All right. I'll see Jasmine tomorrow, and I'll see you on Monday. Or Tuesday. What's the day? Thursday. Yeah, I'll see you Tuesday. Good luck with your leg, your foot. How are you today, Greg?
February 1st. It's my next appointment.
Oh, I thought you had one today.
No, I changed it. I was able to change it.
Okay.
So that's what I was able to do. So next time we meet, we'll have a new president.
Yes, sir. And it's a great country we live in that we can have this change of leadership peacefully. You know, it's not a coup that takes over to put in a new leader. You know, the founding fathers did a great job setting up this government for that transfer of leadership to transfer peacefully. And, you know, I guess it's a revolution in a way because we were able to vote and vote in the leaders we want to take the country in the direction that hopefully we all want. Sometimes that happens, you know, to the way we want it to go. Sometimes it doesn't happen the way we want it to go. But, you know, hopefully, you know, I wish Donald Trump the best of success with his inauguration and his presidency, and I hope he's successful.
I think the country just needs a big prayer.
I agree with you. I was trying not to get too political, but, you know, I hope he makes America great again. He's got his job cut out for him. But I hope the best for him.
Same here. See you next Tuesday.
All right. See you next Tuesday.
Okay. Oh, yeah.
Dorsets or Suffolks? Oh, this is your hair sheet. Oh. Oh. How come? You know what I think I would cross? That's good. Well, I've been doing some research, trying to put some numbers together. You know, and I'm thinking I'm going to, you know, with the market wanting 75, maybe pound lean. They want them meaty, right? I like to get Dorsets, because they breed out of season, all spring lambs. And go put a Chevy Ram on. Those things are meaty. I'm not worried about the height. I'm worried about meatiness. You go the blackface. You know, you got 75-pound lamb, you got all bone. You know, if I can sell a 75-pound lamb as a chunk, I think I get a premium price. And I should be able to do that in about 3 months. They're going to suck a mama if I have to be. They should be able to grow I don't think they have anything to offer. You know what you could do? Put a wool sheet. You already got them. They don't cost a lot to feed. I'd sell the ram. I'd sell the lambs, and I'd just breed her to a wool sheep. You've already got her paid for. She's not gonna be. I mean, she may not. She probably won't win. You know, you breed her to a wool sheep because she's bigger. But I'll just go that route. I mean, you know, if you need the number, just sales and cash flow, you already got a problem. And they breed in season. Really? Doing what? Oh, yeah, that's right. You work with your guys. I heard he does a good job. He just fits to a friend of mine's work. And it's a not. And my friends too. I was going to go look at it. I haven't. I've never met him. I've met his wife. Horse shows, Tina. She sure seemed like a nice lady. And her husband, my farrier, as well. He's awesome. See, I like that already. Right.